Okay, let's start. Okay. So, here is the concept map only, says, no? Okay, siguro. Simula na tayo. So, okay. There are two classification of lease. One is finance lease and the other one is operating lease. When we say finance lease, this is a classification of lease that substantially transfers all the risks and rewards related to the ownership of the underlying asset or the lease asset. Again, finance lease is a classification of lease that substantially transfers all the risks and rewards related to the ownership of the underlying asset or the lease asset. Okay. So, this is governed by IFRS 16. Okay? Now, the second classification of lease is the operating lease. Actually, the technical definition of operating lease, these are short-term leases or low-value leases. When we say short-term leases, this may be viewed at the angle na 1 year is the maximum tenor of the lease or below. Pwede mo siyang tingnan sa anggulong yan. Okay? Then, these are also called low-value leases. Low-value leases, the standards did not provide the definition of a low value. Meaning, this is now a matter of professional judgment. Okay? This operating lease may be also defined as a classification of lease other than finance lease. But class, the option related to identification of lease, whether that is an operating lease, is at the option of the lessor. Meaning kapag si lessor na-identify niya yan as operating lease, mawalang magagawa si lessee. Meaning that is susunod lang siya si lessee. Kasi by default, under IFRS 16, si lessee laging finance lease. Okay? Nagiging operating lease lang siya if the lessor opted to classify the lease based on the qualification of that lease being a low-value lease or a short-term lease. Sakalang magiging operating lease si lessee. Okay? Again, finance lease is a classification of lease that substantially transfers all the risks and rewards related to the ownership of the underlying asset. While operating lease, these are short-term leases or low-value leases. Short-term, the tenor of the lease is at a maximum of 1 year or below. And low-value leases, this is a matter of professional judgment. And the option for a lease to be classified as an operating lease, being short-term or low-value leases, is at the option of the lessor. Okay. There are indicators of finance lease. There are so many indicators of finance lease. However, class, these are the four major items given in an examination for a certain lease be classified as finance lease. And these indicators, there are four, lima nga yan eh. Yung panlima yung specialized in nature. However, madalang siyang ibigay. Okay, and these are the four major indicators of finance lease. And at least one of these indicators is enough for a lease be considered as a finance lease. Okay, the indicators of finance lease are one, transfer of ownership. Okay, when the covenant or the lease agreement reflects that there is a transfer of ownership at the end of the lease term, that is an indicator of finance lease. Then we have the purchase option. Purchase option that is exercisable. What is a purchase option? A purchase option is an option granted to the lessee to purchase the property at the end of the lease term, to purchase the underlying asset subject of lease at the end of the lease term. Why is that this is exercisable? Exercisable in the sense that the price, no? So the option price to purchase the underlying asset is what? Substantially lower than the fair value of the asset at the end of the lease term. Again, purchase option is an option granted to the lessee, wherein the lessee has the option to purchase the underlying asset or the lease asset at an amount that is substantially lower than the fair value of the asset at the end of the lease term. Okay? Then we have the 75% rule. Wala naman sa standard 75% rule. Tinawag ko lang yan. 75% rule in the sense that you are comparing the lease term and the remaining useful life of the asset. Okay? So when we say 75% rule, that the lease term is at least 75% versus the remaining useful life of the underlying asset. Okay, the underlying asset is the lease asset. The underlying asset is a terminology used in the new standards. Sa lumang standards, ang tawag dyan lease asset. But those two can be used interchangeably. Okay? Then we have the 90% rule. This should have been letter D. 90% rule. Tawag ko lang din yan. The 90% rule is the comparison of the present value of the lease payments versus the fair value of the asset at the inception of the lease. That the present value of the lease payments is at least 90% versus the fair value of the asset at the inception of the lease. Okay? And these are the four major indicators of finance lease. And at least one of these is enough for a certain lease be classified as finance lease. Again, what are those indicators? One, transfer of ownership. The second one is the purchase option that is exercisable. Sa lumang standards, ang tawag dyan bargain purchase option. Sa bagong standards, ang tawag purchase option that is exercisable. Then we have the 75% rule that the lease term is at least 75% versus the remaining useful life of the underlying asset. And the last one is the 90% rule, wherein the present value of the lease payments is at least 90% versus the fair value of the asset at the inception of the lease. Baka meron pang isang idagdag o gamitin sa board exam that is specialized in nature. When an underlying asset or a lease asset is specialized in nature, that is considered to be a finance lease. Specialized in the sense that is customized, no? To provide the need of the lessee. Okay? So, kung papansinin mo dito, under finance lease class, dalawa yung pag-uusapan natin. One is the lease liability and the right of use asset. Okay? The lease liability is the present value of the lease payments. The right of use asset, nililipat mo na kasi yung lahat ng risks and rewards related to the underlying asset. Meaning the right of use asset is an indicator of finance lease. That the right of use asset is included as part of the non-current asset of the lessee. Okay? Hindi mo nga lang siya nakikita as one line item because this is merged, no, in the property, plant, and equipment presented in the books of the lessee. Okay? Pero some, no, may nakikita na ako ngayon na nire-reflect nila. Pero this should have been included as part of the disclosure and part of the whole property, plant, and equipment that is to be shown in the books of the lessee. Okay? So, dalawa yan. The lease liability and the right of use asset. Ang problema dito, sa lease liability, you are using the present value of the lease payments. So, we must identify first what are the components of the lease payments. Ito yon. There are five components of lease payments. One is the fixed rental payments, the variable rental payments, the purchase option that is exercisable, the guaranteed residual value, and the termination penalty. Again, there are five items that constitute the lease payments, and you must memorize this by heart, no? Fixed rental payments, variable rental payments, purchase option that is exercisable, the guaranteed residual value, and the termination penalty. Let's explore this guaranteed residual value. Guaranteed residual value is the guaranteed amount of the underlying asset, no, at the end of the lease term. However, class, there is another requirement for this item be included as part of the lease payments. And what is that? That the lease asset should revert to the lessor at the end of the lease term. Ito siya. That the lease asset reverts to the lessor at the end of the lease term before this residual value be considered as part of the lease payments. One that should be guaranteed by the lessee, and the other one, the lease asset, should revert to the lessor at the end of the lease term. So in theory, kapag tinanong ka ng lease payments, lima yan, fixed rental payments, variable rental payments, purchase option that is exercisable, you have your guaranteed residual value and the termination penalty. Pero pag nagsosolve ka na ng problems class, hindi pwedeng magsama ang purchase option tsaka guaranteed residual value. Bakit? Purchase option kasi, once the lessee exercise the option to purchase, mapupunta ang underlying asset sa lessee. But in item D, the requirement for this one to be included as part of the lease payments, the other requirements aside from being guaranteed, that should revert, no? The lease asset should revert to the lessor at the end of the lease term. So meaning yung asset dito, yung lease property, mapupunta sa lessor. Dito naman sa purchase option, ang lease asset or underlying asset mapupunta sa lessee. Kaya hindi yan nagsasabay sa problem solving. Okay? Hindi pwedeng magsabay yan. Okay? Kaya kung ikaw nagsasolve ng problem, then nakita mo, meron kang purchase option at meron ka pang guaranteed residual value, sigurado ako nasa maling daan yung tinatahak mo. Okay? So, ayusin mo yon. Okay? Now, so, ito na siya. Pero ang sabi class, present value of the lease payments. So, present value daw. Ibig sabihin, these are just your lease payments. Ibig sabihin, ang kailangan mo, i-multiply pa to sa present value factor. Okay? Yan yun. So, this fixed rental payment, since it involves series of payments, this will now be multiplied with the present value factor of an annuity. It may be an ordinary annuity or annuity due. You will use the present value factor of an ordinary annuity if the date of transaction did not coincide with the date of first lease payments. Then you will use the present value of an annuity due if the date of transaction coincides with the date of first lease payments. Okay, we have the variable rental payments. The variable rental payments, the only difference between the variable rental payments and the fixed rental payments is the amount. So in letter A, as the name implies, fix ang rental payments mo all throughout the lease term. However, under letter B, variable, it varies because it is based on the consumer price index. Okay? But again, these are series of payments, so this will also use the present value of an annuity. Ordinary or annuity due, those nature, again, would be simply like this. If the date of transaction did not coincide with the date of first lease payments, use the ordinary annuity. While if the date of transaction coincide with the first lease payments, use the annuity due. But there should be a remeasurement here of a liability if the consumer price index goes up or goes down based on the base year. Yun lang ang pagkakaiba nito dun sa letter A. In letter C, ito na nga yung purchase option that is exercisable. And this can be exercised at the end of the lease term. Therefore, we are just talking into a single specific date, and that is at the end of the lease term. So, you will be using the present value factor of 1. The guaranteed residual value is a guaranteed amount of the lease asset or the underlying asset at the end of the lease term. And again, we are dealing with a specific date here, and that is at the end of the lease term. Therefore, we will be using the present value factor of 1. Termination penalty is this. There are sometimes embodied in the covenant or in the lease agreement that either the lessee or the lessor can pre-terminate the lease. So dito pumapasok yan. If it is stipulated in the contract that the lessee or the lessor can pre-terminate the lease, let's say a 5-year lease term, the lessee or the lessor can pre-terminate the lease at the end of the 4th year. However, if you opted to pre-terminate, there is a corresponding termination penalty. And that is the one that we are talking here. And the termination penalty is again an amount subsequent to the pre-termination of the lease, the exercise of the pre-termination. And the exercise of the pre-termination is inclined into a specific date, meaning, let's say, at the end of the fourth year. So that is an action that can took place, okay, at a specific date. Therefore, we will be also using the present value factor of 1. Okay? So, itong present value factors na to, pag nagawa mo na, so imumultiply mo na lang sa lease payments, makukuha mo na yung present value ng lease payments. However, class, pag sinabi mong present value factor, that is dependent to an effective rate. Okay? Dito, class, sa lease, dalawa kasi ang rate na makikita mo. One is the implicit rate and the other one is the incremental borrowing rate. What is the rate to be used, sir? In generating the present value factors, you will use the implicit percentage. Okay? Do not use the incremental borrowing rate. Okay? Pero class, hindi dahil sa walang silbi lang itong incremental borrowing rate. There are instances na pwede mo siyang gamitin. Kailan? One, in the absence of the implicit rate. Idagdag mo to, inote mo sa tabi mo. Dalawa kasi instance niyan na pwede mong gamitin ng incremental borrowing rate. One, in the absence of implicit rate. Okay? Number two, if the implicit rate is not known to the lessee. Oh, those are the two instances wherein the incremental borrowing rate will be used as the basis in getting the present value factor to identify the present value of the lease payments. Again, there are two rates given in a lease problem, the implicit rate and the incremental borrowing rate. The default rate that is to be used is the implicit percentage. However, incremental borrowing percentage can be used whenever na one, there is no implicit rate provided. So in the absence of implicit rate, that's the time that you will use the incremental borrowing percentage. And what is the other instance? If the implicit rate is not known to the lessee. If the implicit rate is not known to the lessee, then you will also use the incremental borrowing percentage. Okay? So tumutok tayo sa present value of the lease payments. Why? Dahil ang initial measurement ng lease liability mo ay present value ng lease payments. Ano ba ang subsequent measurement niyan, sir? Ang subsequent measurement ng liability mo ay at amortized cost using the effective interest method of amortization. Madali na yon, kasi matagal na natin ginagawa yung effective interest method of amortization. Again, the initial measurement of the lease liability is the present value of the lease payments. And the subsequent measurement is at amortized cost using the effective interest method of amortization. Kabisado mo na yan using memory plus and memory recall. Let's go here to the right of use asset. The right of use asset involves these five or four items. One is the lease payments, no? The present value of the lease payments. But be careful with this. Okay, what is to be transferred here as a value to be considered as the first line item in getting the right of use asset? These are the lease liabilities that are to be paid in the future. What do I mean? There are lease payments that is what? Payable in advance. Diba? Nagbibigay ka agad ng advance. So meaning, what is to be transferred here is the carrying value of the liability. Let's say January 1, nagbigay din siya kagad ng advance payment ng January 1. So, the carrying value of the liability, syempre minus the advance payment. And that is the one to be transferred here. Those lease liability that remains unpaid, no, at the time of transaction. Mamaya, magiging malinaw to. Basta, this item should be a liability that is to be paid in the future. Meaning this already considers all the advance payments. Binawas na. Okay? Then the next line item is advance payments minus the lease incentives. Then we have the initial direct cost. Initial direct cost, these are the other necessary costs in the negotiation and arrangement of the lease. Then we have the present value of the decommissioning and restoration costs. This decommissioning and restoration costs, minsan kasi sa kontrata, let's say, ang inuupahan mo ay lupa. Okay? Kung lupa yan, tapos sabi mo sa lessor, magpapatayo ako dyan ng structure. Then sabi mo sa kanya, sabi ng lessor sa'yo, sige okay lang. Pero kapag tapos ng lease term, pwede bang kung paano mo kinuha yung loteng yan, ibalik mo rin sa dati niyang itsura. Ibig sabihin, pag nagtayo ka ng structure doon, at the end of the lease term, gigibain mo yon. Kasi pag sinoli mo yan sa lessor, yun ang usapan niya, ibalik mo yan sa dating itsura. So yung mga structures gigibain mo, meaning that would entail cost. And that is your decommissioning and restoration cost. Why is that this is at present value? Because the amount to be incurred by the lessee in restoring the property should be made at the end of the lease term. So sa end ng lease term pa yon. Kung 5 years yan, at the end of the 5th year pa yon. Eh kung 20x1 lang ang tinatanong, the first year, so ibig sabihin, kailangan mo yung present value ng amount na gagastusin mo. Let's say 200,000 ang gagastuhin mo sa pagpapagiba ng mga structures na yon at the end of the lease term. So that 200,000 is a future value, a future amount to be incurred by the lessee in restoring the property. But what if we are just asking the right of use asset for the first year? So what is the present value of the 200,000 today? Kaya siya naka-present value. So that is now the right of use asset. So this will now be your initial measurement of the right of use asset. Okay? Then what is the subsequent measurement, sir, of the right of use asset? That is only at its carrying value. Carrying value that is cost minus the accumulated depreciation. And that is your carrying value. Ang problema mo dyan is the accumulated depreciation because you are dealing with depreciation expense. Sa pag-compute ng depreciation expense, bakit sir, mahirap ba? Hindi naman. Kasi ang pinapagamit lang dito ay straight line method. O straight line method lang pala sir, di madali lang. Plus hindi ganun kasimple sa lease. Why? You have your cost here, straight line method, cost minus the residual value. Divided by what number of years? We're now talking here to 2 years. Two independent years. Ano yung 2 years na yon? One is the lease term and the other one is the remaining useful life of the asset. So what should be the denominator to be used in getting the depreciation expense? And this is the concept behind. Kahit wag mo na itong tingnan. Ano yon? If there is a transfer of ownership or a potential transfer of ownership, okay, ulitin natin. If there is a transfer of ownership or a potential transfer of ownership. Meaning if there would be a transfer of ownership or a probability that the lease asset will be transferred to the lessee at the end of the lease term, then depreciate the asset using useful life. Okay, kailan mo masasabing may transfer of ownership if that is embedded or included in the covenant or lease agreement? Kailan mo masasabing magkakaroon ng potential transfer of ownership? If there is what? A purchase option. Once the lessee opted to purchase the property, there is now a probability, no? Whenever that there is a bargain, whenever that is a purchase, there is a purchase option that is exercisable, there would always be a probability or potential that the buyer would exercise the option to purchase at the end of the lease term. Therefore, there is a probability that the lease asset be transferred to the lessee at the end of the lease term. If that is the case, use the useful life as the basis in depreciating the asset. Okay? Yun lang. So, ibig sabihin, kapag wala, if there is no transfer of ownership or even a potential transfer of ownership at the end of the lease term, depreciate the asset, the shorter between the useful life and the lease term. Okay? If there would be no transfer of ownership or even a potential transfer of ownership at the end of the lease term, then depreciate the asset using the shorter between the useful life and the lease term. And we have here your residual value. Okay, residual value. Kasi cost minus residual value, yan yung straight line method eh. Okay, ito yon. This residual value will be used as a deduction in computing the depreciation expense. Ganito kasi yan eh. Residual value may be guaranteed or unguaranteed residual value. Okay, ito na ulit yung konsepto. If there is a transfer of ownership or a potential transfer of ownership at the end of the lease term, then deduct the residual value, whether the residual value is guaranteed. Okay? Again, if there is a transfer of ownership or a potential transfer of ownership, then deduct the residual value, whether the residual value is guaranteed or unguaranteed. Okay? Kapag naman, sa kabila, if there is no transfer of ownership or even a potential, not even a potential transfer of ownership at the end of the lease term, then you will only deduct the residual value if the residual value is guaranteed. Again, if there is no transfer of ownership or not even a potential transfer of ownership at the end of the lease term, then you would only deduct the residual value if the residual value is guaranteed. And that is the whole concept of the lessee accounting. Oh, ayan, nasa one page ka lang. Okay, mahaba yan sa libro. Mga 6, 7, or 8 pages yung pinag-usapan natin. Okay, the last to be discussed is the executory cost. Executory cost is treated as expense. Okay? So with that, no, we are now ready to solve problems related to lessee accounting.